Teasdale uses the most basic elements of language to evoke the agony of the soul, at war with the joys of life. Her superficially simplistic verses hide much in their words, their letters, their signifiers and signs, the meaning of their semiotics. All the better to make room for the inherent music of her poetry. Yes, there are patterned end rhymes and gently metered turns of phrase, but there is so much more to be gleaned when we just take one closer look. I mean, for example, listen to this simple alliteration that lulls the listener into somnolence. Let it be you who lean above me on my last day. Let it be you who shut my eyelids. You will know when all that in silence you always knew, though I have loved, I loved no other as I love you. Or hear this example. I am wild. I will sing to the trees. I will sing to the stars in the sky. I love, I am loved. Although late Victorian in terms of the structure of her poetic verse, Teasdale can be better understood within the context of a much larger world of literary New York in the 1920s. And really picture it, right? This is post-World War I jubilation, the advent of modernism, immigration and cross-cultural encounters cheek to jowl on the streets of Manhattan. The 19th Amendment, which granted equal voting rights for both men and women. Think of other poets like Lola Ridge, Federico Garcia Lorca, Evelyn Scott, Wallace Stevens, and especially one of my favorites from the Harlem Renaissance, Langston Hughes. His poem especially, The Weary Blues, which drones, oh, drowsy syncopated tune. The art of this period in New York was a radical turn from the past, whereby social construction and stratification, pain and sinful joy are blatantly exposed and celebrated. For this rather conservative woman, moving to New York represented a sense of freedom. In her image of the city, Teasdale recognizes both the tragedy and the emancipation possible in anonymity, where cries are hidden, secrets are disguised, where leafless trees with no sign of leaf or bud are silently waiting for spring. In the city, a face is glimpsed and then forgotten, and yet all the soul's sorrows are revealed. The regular rhymes of Teasdale's verse depict in words the urban jungle of the city, organized in a simple grid from east to west, north to south, interrupted by Olmsted's planned chaos of Central Park, the emerald heart of that island. In Teasdale's New York, form becomes indistinguishable from nature, an ocean of roofs where window lights from tall towers bloom from walls like climbing flowers.
Thank you.
It's not. even from her early childhood, Teasdale had a late romantic affection for the Arthurian legends of unrequited love. Tristan and Isolde, Lancelot and Guinevere, Helios and Melisande. The medieval women from these tales represented a new psychology of the feminine. In early 20th century sensibility, these were all women searching for freedom in love. Unrequited love represents a kind of pure love that physical consummation destroys through pain or betrayal, or even simply the loss of desire. In the poem, But Not to Me, which, by the way, you heard beautifully sung in the first set on the program, Teasdale confronts the battle between love on some spiritual plane and love manifest in physical action. In this work, the simple text describing a peaceful April night gives way to the unexpected truncation of the refrain. The April night is still and sweet with flowers on every tree. Peace comes to them on quiet feet, but not to me. My peace is hidden in his breast, where I shall.